All right, welcome back. I am Douglas Beaumont, the Director of Religious Education for St. Joseph's Catholic Church, and today we are looking at Part 3, The Problem of Evil. So in the first two parts of this series, we looked at the fact that God did not create evil. Evil is not a thing with its own existence, like a rock or sunlight, but rather it's the absence of good that should be there. Much in the way that a hole in the ground or darkness is real and yet isn't really a thing that exists of its own, and therefore God is not directly responsible for it being there. And then we started looking at the logical problem of evil, which basically says it doesn't seem like an all-good, all-powerful God could exist given that there is evil in the world. But we saw that there are some very serious and false assumptions behind that argument, namely that an all-good being always eliminates all evil. So far, we've basically just been looking at things philosophically, metaphysics, logic. Now we're going to look at them theologically. And this is where Christianity has something to offer that other religions, even theistic religions, do not necessarily have available. And for this argument, I'm going to be relying on Professor Eleanor Stump from St. Louis University. She starts out basically the way everyone else did, by acknowledging that we have an omnipotent, omniscient, perfectly good God, that there is evil in the world. But then she says there is a morally sufficient reason for God to allow evil, and this is that evil actually helps people freely choose salvation. Okay, so this argument is worth unpacking a bit. What does it mean to say that evil helps people go to heaven? Well, Professor Stump basically walks us through salvation history. First, she says, people have defective free wills. They don't always choose good, or they don't always choose the best. Of course, our wills are always seeking something that we see as being good, but sometimes we don't pick the best. Second, it is not possible for people in that condition to go to heaven. Why? Because God is the ultimate good, and heaven is the place where people who choose the ultimate good over all the other goods get to go. Heaven isn't just a reward for good people. It is the vision of God. It is seeing the ultimate good, infinite goodness, so much goodness that we could never even consider desiring something else. But God doesn't want to force that on us. He wants to give us the choice. And to give us the choice, we have to choose between lower goods on our way to Him. Now, it might seem like God should just fix our wills. Why doesn't He just make them non-defective? Why doesn't He just give us wills that always choose the very best? The problem is, that would eliminate the very good of freedom. God cannot fix this defect by simply removing it, because that would violate free will. You see, in order to have free will, I have to be able to choose between lesser goods. And if God took that ability away from me, I wouldn't have freedom anymore, which itself would be an evil, like we talked about last time. Now, what about me? Can I fix it? Stump says people cannot fix this defect by themselves, for they would have to choose perfection with an imperfect will. In other words, in order for me to consistently and always choose the highest good, I would have to have a will that wasn't defective. But I do, so I can't fix my will myself by constantly choosing the highest good. So, Professor Stump says, what helps people in that condition is an evil world. You see, even though I know there's something wrong with my will, I may not have any real reason to want it to be fixed if I'm satisfied with the world that I have to choose in front of me. You know, someone who always gets everything they want and never really has anything to struggle against could very easily get used to just living with the lower goods of the world. By getting the higher goods of this world, they may lack the ability to even care about any higher good than what they already have. However, a person who has suffered, a person who has seen this evil world for what it really is, even their defective will is going to want something more good than what the world has to offer. And so when they see that in order to escape the lower goods of this evil world and get the greatest good of God, their will has to be fixed, having a fixed will can become the good that they desire. In other words, they can will that their will be fixed. And because they are freely desiring God to fix their will, God can fix it without violating their freedom. It requires an imperfect world full of imperfect people in order to get some of them to perfection. Is it worth it? Well, consider this analogy. Suppose scientists came up with a shot that hurt for 1 second, but that somehow guaranteed 100 years of complete and total happiness. Most people would definitely choose 1 second of suffering if it meant 100 years of happiness. And the reason I know that is that we do things every day that we don't want to do in order to get something that we want. Well, imagine if instead of 1 second of suffering, it was 100 years of suffering. By the same analogy, you would get 3.3 trillion years of happiness if you suffered for 100 years. Now, what's amazing to think is that what God is offering us is literally infinitely better than that deal. Even if someone lives to be 100 years old, and even if they suffer every single day of that 100 years, if that is what it took to get them to infinite bliss forever, that deal sells itself. St. Paul said in his letter to the Romans, "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." Now, not only does Christianity have an answer to the problem of evil that is not available to most other religions, and certainly not available to atheists, Catholic Christianity takes it another degree further. I remember as an evangelical being very confused by a verse in St. Paul's letter to the Colossians, namely verse 1:24. Here St. Paul writes, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I complete what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church." This verse never really made sense to me because I had always been told that Jesus' work on the cross was complete. You know, he did it all to him I owe. And there is truth in those statements, but the truth that gets missed a lot of times is that Christ's sufferings on the cross, in a sense, didn't end there. Rather, they were transferred to his body on earth when his body went to heaven. As members of the church, we are actually called to suffer, not just to get ourselves to heaven, but to help others get to heaven. So even suffering that is maybe no longer necessary for us to want to escape this world and be with God forever can still be of benefit to others. Atheism doesn't have any answers. Atheism makes suffering unbearable, because it has it take place in the context of a universe that doesn't have any purpose. No suffering is wasted for the Christian. Now, finally, I want to go over the emotional problem of evil, and this is where we want to be really careful, because the emotional problem of evil really has to do with individual suffering. A person who has suffered a great evil, either directly or indirectly, may not be terribly concerned with the metaphysical or the logical arguments from evil. And even though they may state their feelings in a form that kind of follows the logical problem of evil, rather, they are hurting. That is not the time to start rattling off these responses that I've just given you. During emotional suffering, this is not the time to be pointing those things out. And it's especially not the time to be trying to guess at what those goods might be. That is a conversation for another time. Right now, what we need is consolation. We need to let them vent. Get those emotions out so that they can start thinking clearly. And then when that takes place, and it's time for that intellectual conversation, we can be ready. The problem of suffering is not diminished by answering the problem of evil. Although having answers to the problem of evil should make suffering more bearable, it doesn't make it go away. Because here's the thing with evil and suffering. If there is a good reason for God to allow evil, then it's going to be evil. It's going to cause suffering. Whatever the good of that suffering accomplishes, that good would go away if the suffering wasn't there. So having these thoughts in someone's head is not going to make the suffering go away. It may diminish it a little. But the main thing that we're trying to do is give people hope. There is a reason for this evil and suffering. It is not going to be wasted. And in the end, if we keep our eyes on the greatest good, then we will be rewarded for that faithfulness. Even when we are hurting, we can remember that God is a good, good Father. Good parents do not shield their kids from all possible suffering. We allow them to take the risks that increase their virtue. We allow them to go through painful procedures that will ultimately keep them more healthy. And even though we can't understand all evil or come up with a specific reason for all evil, we can trust that God loves us anyway. Just as I can't always explain to my kids why the suffering I'm allowing in their lives is good for them, they can know that I love them and trust me through that pain. The reason we know God is a good, good father is not because he showers us with riches and gives us lives of ease. God shows his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God let his son suffer for our good, die for our good, so that we can receive the grace to ask God to fix us and help us be with him forever. To go back to Dr. Haslinger's argument, the Christian can say this: God exists, so there will be no evil someday. This life is not what we were made for. This world is not our home. Rather, this world is preparation. It is the training of the soul to be able to choose the greatest good and withstand infinite goodness in the beatific vision that we will experience in heaven. In one of the final verses of the final book of the Bible, St. John the Revelator says this: God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. These are not the promises that God gives us in this life. Indeed, God warns us, promises us in his word, that suffering is coming. It should be expected. This life is a veil of tears, and any view that doesn't teach that is not Christian. However, it is also not Christian to lose hope because of this life. Ultimately, God is preparing us for him. And if we choose that good, the reward will be worth the struggle. All right, I hope this video has been helpful to you. If it has, would you mind giving the video a like? That helps YouTube find more content like this. And be sure to subscribe to St. Joseph's channel and click that bell if you want to be notified when new videos come out. Until next time, I am Douglas Beaumont. God bless you.